17. 1 Kings chapter 17. And I don't know if you're having the same kind of day as my son Joe. So this morning, Joseph, it was hard to get him out of the bed. And then when he went to the table to eat his breakfast, my wife was telling him, you know, X, Y, and Z for the day. And you could just see the look on his face, like it was like, I know it's Wednesday. It feels like Wednesday. I'm not sure that this is going to be a good day. So he went and sat down. He's got a train track and things that he's been building in the living room. It's all over the place. He's adding to it every night. So he's got this train track there, and he went and kind of sat down and looked at it and was thinking to play. My wife said, "Now, Joe, go get the clothes that have been folded, put these away." And then he just went over and grabbed his lessons to do for the day. And I'm like, this, I said, "No, she didn't say that." And then we had to go in there and just talk a little bit. And I said, "Now listen, you've already had trouble getting out of the bed. You've already had trouble listening to simple commands." I said, "Is it going to be one of those kind of days?" And he's just looking up like, yes. I'm like, okay, so let's nip it in the bud. Let's start at the beginning. And it I don't know, it feels like that kind of a day. Some weeks as we're singing the footsteps of Jesus, you know, walking is boring. Boring in the way that they even have in some gyms. They've got the screens. You can even buy machines where you have a screen, and it looks like you're walking through a forest or you're walking on the road. Every day when I come in, I see the same lady walking this way. And then normally about an hour later, if I'm walking by, I see her walking that way. And steps are just what they are. They're steps. We're not sprinting to heaven. We're not dashing to heaven. We're not, you know, running to heaven. We're walking. And sometimes the walk is long. The walk is hard. Sometimes we're tired. A lot of times it's very hot. The elements are against us. But one day we'll take that final step, and then it'll be in heaven. One day, either the trumpet will sound, or we'll take that last step and we'll be in the presence of the Lord and all of the steps that we've taken. So we're allowed to have days where we just kind of look up to the Lord, and yes, it's one of those days. And I don't know if you've had those kind of days, but I could see it on his face this morning. And as adults, we're not really allowed those kind of days very much, and neither are our kids, but it's good to know that the Lord is in charge of the good days and the bad. So we're going to look this morning at 1 Kings chapter 17. And we're going to talk this morning, message 3 of Can You Relate? And today we're going to talk about dirty birds and dry brooks, where God puts us and how God provides for us. And sometimes it's not the way that we expect, but God always meets our need. He always takes care of us, even though it's hard. So chapter 17, verse number 1, we see here, verse 1, "And Elijah the Tishbite, who is of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, Elijah, saying, Get thee hence, turn thee eastward, hide thyself by the brook Cherith that is before Jordan. And it shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook. And I have commanded the ravens, these birds, to feed thee there. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith that is before Jordan." So we're going to see shortly that the brook is going to dry up where God sent him. So the place of provision quickly becomes a place where it kind of just becomes very poor, and he can't stay there any longer. So let's look at our introduction. We know this. We've looked at it the last 3 weeks. Elijah was a mighty man, a great prophet. Since Moses and John the Baptist, those three are great prophets in God's word. He had a short ministry that we don't know a lot about. His background, his mom, his dad, his hometown, don't know a lot. But he is an important character. And of course, he's a very colorful person because he ate strange things. He wore strange things. He was a gruff guy. We like to think of him as that type of individual. He wasn't someone that was genteel, I guess you'd say, or soft. He was a man that just spoke and meant what he said. But at the same time, God used him, this gruff guy, to bring about revival. And it was through Elijah's ministry. We can see, though, even though he was greatly used of God, his life was in turmoil. He was being chased. He felt alone. He became depressed. He ran away. All of these things. You can see he was bold at times and decisive. Other times he was kind of fearful and tentative. Talking before everyone came in, mentioning to Kay and I think some of the others here, talking about to parent your parents. You know, my sister, is her birthday was yesterday. She's older than I am. My parents are both 71 years old. They're not old. I don't look at that as old. Maybe the closer I get in that way, they're not old. But my sister lives down the road. My brother now lives at Fort Jackson in Columbia, so he's a little further down the road. But when we're home or when I talk to my sister, she's doing what the oldest child would do, and one that lives close and has been there through my mom's heart attack and the COVID stuff and all that. But she forgets, you know, mama and daddy still have their independence. You can't parent them. You can't just tell them what to do. They still have their free will, so don't do that. There'll come a point when that maybe that'll happen. But there comes a time in our life where at one point we were very bold, decisive, independent, and there are times in our life where that independence and that boldness, that decisiveness begins to wane. Well, Elijah knew, he had experienced the gamut of emotions serving the Lord. And it's not that those who serve the Lord should always have a stiff upper lip. We've got all the answers. We don't cry. Don't ever let them see you cry. We actually don't always have the answers. I mean, we have God's word, but how do we face different challenges when we are serving the Lord, trying to do what is right? And this is what Elijah was faced with. So he demonstrated victory and defeat, followed by recovery, and ultimately knew the depths of depression, so much so that he wanted to die. Literally, just, Lord, kill me now, take me now, I'm done. So the lessons that we're learning along our study is that ministry or serving the Lord, being a Christian, can be hard. It can be lonely and disappointing. We've got our prayer sheet. Many of your family members, some of them don't know the Lord, and they might look at you kind of odd. Maybe some of them did know the Lord, and they grew up in church, and like, no. I had lunch with a pastor yesterday. He says one of his leaders in his church, one of the leaders, his grown child, said to him, I'm done. I'm out. It's over. I don't want to be a Christian. I don't want to be part of this anymore. And he says, and I just met with this man. He says, and all we did was just pray together, cry together. He says, how can you help someone when their kids walk away? Well, Elijah understood that ministry, the life following the Lord, serving him, was hard, lonely, and disappointing. It's not always, you know, punching in and punching out the time clock. There are apparent blessings, and then there are things that, you know, we don't always see the time card until we get to heaven. But it requires ministry. Serving the Lord requires prayer and personal time with God. And Elijah experienced both of those. And a man who was as bold and fiery as Elijah, who was close to God in prayer, spent personal time with the Lord, still was depressed. He was still disappointed, discouraged. So we're going to see that he was a man last week of confrontation. Number one, we saw this. We won't rehearse this again, but the 2 points just to lay out was his story revolves around 2 commands, go hide yourself and go show yourself. So Elijah confronted wrong, and when it was time to hide himself, God says go. He served the Lord privately, but when it was time to stand up publicly, he did the same thing. He was the same in front of people as he was behind the scenes. So we saw last week, Elijah was a man of confrontation. Now number 2, Elijah was a man of concealment. So God concealed him or hid him. Now we only looked at A, B, and C, so let's look at those. So why did God send Elijah to the brook Cherith? We said last week it was maybe politically, it was advantageous. They were going to hunt him. It was going to stop raining, and eventually the crops would dry up. The heat would destroy everything. A famine would ensue, and then poverty. So somebody has to be blamed for this. They don't serve God, the big G God. They were serving Baal and Ashtaroth. So therefore, Elijah becomes public enemy number 1. So God sent him there to not only protect him, but to provide for him so that he could trust. Letter B we laid these two out. Elijah received the promises of God. He listened. God says, I want you to do this. And he received it. Yes, sir, I'll do this. Letter C, he believed it. He acted on God's promises. And we see that in verse number 5. God said, you need to go. And he obeyed. Well, you mean, what do you mean birds are going to feed me? What do you mean I'm going to a brook? It's not going to rain. This is not going to last. Is this well thought out, Lord? Well, of course. God always has a plan. Now look at verses 6 and 7 of chapter 17. It says this in verse 6, and the ravens brought him, Elijah, bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. We're not told how long, but obviously it was long enough to where it affected even Elijah. So we'll start with letter D. So Elijah not only received and believed God's word, but he enjoyed, is the blank there, he enjoyed benefited from God's provisions during a national drought. We're having a national issue. Read last night on the news that 300% more this year, right now, this time this year, than there were last year with the pandemic. Worldwide, there is a national, or could we say a global, and not just the virus of the body, but the virus of legislation, of law, or we're dealing with a national global issue. Can we enjoy God's provisions? Can we enjoy God's word? Can we enjoy the Lord during a time of this? Well, let's look at Elijah's life, and then we'll have to make that decision as we look at God's word in our own. Number one, so we can see that the Creator controls nature. He controls nature. That's the brook and the birds. So something that's streaming, it's natural resource. The birds who God created, but they only care about themselves and the weather. So now the weather is not going to cooperate. Can you imagine if we went for, let's say, 4 years in Florida, no rain at all? Now, I know things have dried up, but can you imagine that? How bone dry it would be. Well, God controls nature. So when we look at events, I watch some of the takes, the videos coming out of Acapulco last night. There was blue lightning. There was some weird stuff. It was very weird. People videoing, buildings are shaking, people are running. First, it was closer to an 8.0 magnitude, and now you're seeing all kinds of crazy things. Well, who controls the weather? Well, we know the Lord does, but sometimes the weather controls us. We let things of this world control us or help us to make our decisions, and it shouldn't be that way. The brook and the birds. So God controls not only nature, natural things, he controls the animals and, of course, the weather. Number two, but God makes special provisions for those who trust him. And in Elijah's case, it was miraculous. I don't believe that if the Lord put me in the Mojave Desert and I was stranded, I don't know, is the Lord going to send vultures to feed me rather than feed on me? I don't know. This is miraculous. I would pray the Lord would provide for me, but there are many people that have died in that fashion. Here we see God provides for those who trust him. And even those that trust in him, many of them never escape the lion's den, the flame, cancer, COVID. Many times they don't escape that, but God gives them provision as they go through it. So number three, what we see here is God gives us help from unexpected sources. And that's the blank there, unexpected sources. Sometimes God treats us like Boaz treated Ruth. We get handfuls on purpose. You know, we live in a world that complains about everything, and they're not thankful for what they have, and everybody's got like this, their handout. Well, God gave to Elijah something that he needed to survive, but from a source that was totally unexpected. If birds fly up and start dropping you food off, breakfast and supper twice a day, it says bread and flesh. He commanded the ravens. So note under here, ravens are unclean. When you read the book of the law, they're unclean birds. They're gross. They're nasty. They forsake their own little babies in times of famine or drought or bad weather. They forsake them, and they only care about themselves. Sounds like some people, right? Well, God used a dirty bird, an unclean animal, something that typically forsakes its own during hard times to take care of his own during a hard time. So what unexpected sources, what places has God provided for you? What has he given to you from a place that you did not expect? When we look at our lives or over our past, we can see that the Lord has always taken care of us, whether it's, you know, to pay a bill. I remember as a senior in college, I didn't have enough money to, and we've told our kids about this, growing up, you know, you don't have everything you want, but it always comes to God's children. He always gives you everything you need. And I remember it was April of that year, my bill was still lacking. I was working two jobs at college trying to make it through. And I remember going to the bill office, you get the note in your box, and I went in there, and I knew how much was lacking, and someone had paid $500 on my bill. And back then, still $500 is a lot. And I asked them, they said, well, somebody just paid it. It was anonymous. I never, till this day, don't know. God sometimes provides for us. It could be through groceries. It could be through an oil change. It could be through someone just sending a card, a phone call, a text. It could be something so small. And often it's unexpected. You know, God uses us to be an unexpected blessing to someone. Maybe your neighbor, maybe a lost loved one or family member. Maybe you have every reason to not bless someone because of, I won't say our nature. Our nature is to, our human nature is to, well, they did this to me, so I'm going to cut you off. I'm done with you. But God can still use us, not trying to spiritualize the text here, but God can use us to be a blessing to others in an unexpected way. And the Bible says when we do that, it heaps coals of fire on their head, but God can use us to be a blessing to others. No doubt these ravens were a blessing to Elijah. Look at number four. So what did God supply him with? Consistency and variety, which we all like in our meals, meat and potatoes. So consistency, that was morning and evening God provided for him. And then variety, bread and meat. So he had the brook, he had something to drink, he had bread and meat. It was great. I met this pastor yesterday at Bono's in Middleburg. I think I've been there one time since we've lived here in 8 years. And when we were in college in Jacksonville, we went a couple of times. And so as we were sitting there, I got a pulled pork sandwich. And I'm telling you, no lie, it was the best pulled pork sandwich ever. There was so much meat on that thing. It was great. I only ate half. I brought the other half home. I told my wife, I said, you've got to see this. This is so much, you know. Well, this is where we've been before. You're getting more grizzled and fat and all this, and it was just measly. This was like a meaty, meaty sandwich. And I brought it home, showed it to her. She says, well, that's going to ruin your supper, and we're going to eat this. So I just ate it right before supper without her looking, and it was good. But consistency, variety, bread, and meat, God gives us what we need just when we need it in our own lives. And sometimes we're, as the song just said, thank you, Lord. We have blessings in our life. We have things that God has provided for us, and we often overlook the miraculous. We live in America. You have either retirement or a job. You're able to go to the grocery store. You can do that safely. There's not armed gunmen coming to hunt you down. There are all of these things that in other countries, pre-COVID and now with COVID, that many people in those countries don't have the opportunity or freedom to do. We live in a great place. God takes care of us. So number five, God supplied Elijah's need until his purpose was fulfilled, and then the brook dried up. So God put him there. He hid him there, and he sent him there and said, you stay there. I'll take care of you until it's time to go. So that was letter D. Elijah enjoyed or benefited from it. Now let's look at letter E, and then we're going to turn to a few verses. So Elijah, the blank here, understood that he was in God's will by a drying brook or in a king's palace. This is our practical end here. Elijah understood that he was in God's will. Can people be in God's will when they're receiving chemo treatments? Are they in God's will? Are they in God's will when their loved one, a spouse, a parent, a child dies? Are they in God's will when they get a bad report from their job and the boss man says, you know, we're going under, we're going to have to cut a few? Are they in God's will when all of these things happen? Well, ultimately, from Elijah's life, when the brook dried up, no doubt he's seeing this happen. It's getting lower and lower, and eventually there's a trickle, and then there's just bone dry. Elijah understood, God sent me here. He's going to take care of me. I'm in God's will either by this brook that's dry or if I'm standing in front of the king, wherever it's at. Now, the Bible says this, he was just like us. He had passions like us, so he had a morning like Job. I can tell this is going to be a bad day. He had a bad 3.5 years, but the Lord was with him. We have those kind of days, but we have to understand that God has a plan for our life, and we shouldn't be like Jonah and run from the dry brook. You know, or Lord, I'm not going to do this. I'm not eating any meat from this unexpected resource. You know what? These dirty birds, I'm not taking any of this. I'll do it myself. And we often think we're so self-sufficient that no one can help us. But God uses these things. So Elijah understood. So look at number one. So Elijah's prayer eventually resulted in famine. And then the brook dried up. Maybe you're praying for your son, your daughter, a friend, a neighbor, a grandchild, a nephew, a niece, somebody. You're praying for them that God will get their attention. And then he does. And the brook dries up. Our prayer, the Bible says, God listens to them. He does answer the prayer. So Elijah prayed. His prayer was the result then of the famine, which then led to the brook drying up. So his prayer not only impacted the nation, it impacted him personally. So that brings us to number two. So we see that the righteous also suffer with the wicked. Did you know that Christians are not immune to COVID or to Fauci or to this government or to whatever? We are suffering right along with people who don't know the Lord. You know, Elijah faced the famine just like Ahab did. They both went through it. The difference is Elijah trusted God, Ahab trusted himself, and we know where that's going to get him. So follow this thought. Number three, sometimes being in God's will puts us in the place of drying brooks. We don't like that necessarily. You know, Jonah was, can we use this? Jonah was out of God's will, but God lovingly corrected him, and he was in the center of God's will in the belly of that well. Now, he could have avoided that whole disaster, but he disobeyed God. God had a way of bringing him back and teaching him the lesson he needed to learn, but he was right where he wanted to be in a place that was very difficult. Joseph, I don't know what he needed to learn. He seemed like he was a good kid. I don't think he was a spoiled brat. It seems like he loved his father. He tried to do what was right, but his father maybe made some mistakes that made the brethren, his sons, other sons, hate him. But Joseph was doing right. But Joseph was sent to Egypt, sold into slavery, lied about from Potiphar's wife that he tried to rape her or tried to do something wrong. He spent time in prison. He was forgotten about. Well, was he in God's will in prison? Was he in God's will in slavery? Was he in God's will in the pit? Sometimes being in God's will puts us in a difficult place. And that's tough. What's a New Testament example? Acts chapter 8. You don't have to turn there, but Philip, we know, as a disciple of the Lord, he had just had a successful ministry. Something, it was great. There was a lot of people. There were thousands being saved. And then all of a sudden, boom, God translated him. He, you know, beamed him over to the desert. And there he is, just him, and there's a guy in a chariot. One other person in a desert. Sometimes God does that, where it's all great, it's all wonderful, and then all of a sudden it dries up. Finances dry up, health dries up, relationships dry up, and it's during those times that we know the Lord's word never is dry, it's never dull, it's never void. So what are we to do when our emotional reservoir dries up? when our physical health reservoir dries up, when all of those things, and you know what I'm talking about, it gets dusty and dry and difficult, and we just kind of don't want to get out of the bed. We don't want to have to do anything. We don't want to have to deal with that. Well, that brings us to number four. Christians have problems. Okay, we're done. There we go. Well, yeah, we have problems. Yes, we know that, but we also have the problem solver. We have the problem solver. And we know that. Joe, Allie's in Algebra 2. She's doing geometry. Joe is doing some new math. He was frustrated this last week doing some of this new math that he's doing. And we talk through that. But, you know, there's always going to be someone who's smarter at solving or doing things than we are. But I read this morning about Jeff Bezos. Bezos, I don't know, Bozos, the guy that owns Amazon, and he has invested in a company, I can't remember the name of it, starts with an A, but that alters the human DNA genome so that you can find the gene or whatever you need to do to get eternal life. He's playing with this. The guy is the richest man in the world. So there's that. He's trying to solve the problem. He's got everything and then some, but now wants to experiment with DNA, find this gene, whatever it is, to give himself, and I guess you can buy that on Amazon, you can be eternal. Well, this people want to solve all types of problems. Why does my marriage not work? Why do my kids not listen? Why do I not make enough money? Why is my health bad? Why, and for him, it's, I want to live forever. Well, we have problems as Christians. And we can't always solve our own problems, much less each other's problems. I'm thankful, you know, as was mentioned, I'm going to mention about Roger and Bobby. You think about that. You've got two people with failing health taking two of their friends with also some failing health at this point. So they're not able to solve their own problem, but it's not keeping them from helping to take care of the problems of other people, and that's how Christians are. So we have problems, but we have the problem solver. Some of our problems are maybe not actual problems, they're just situations the Lord puts us through so that he can show that he can solve them. The equation doesn't compute. I can't figure this out. I don't know what to do. Well, ultimately, the Lord is the problem solver. That brings us to number five. So when we have problems, we have the problem solver. The brook is drying. God sent him there. So Lord, what am I to do? Number five, God will move heaven and earth to care for his kids. Turn to Psalm 91. I love this psalm in particular. Psalm 91. Psalm 90 is a great psalm. It's kind of coupled in here between Psalm 90 and 92. Psalm 91, you can almost see that Elijah could pray this prayer or just rehearse this in his own mind. Verse 1, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Verse 2 of Psalm 91, I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. Surely he will deliver thee from the snare of the fowler. Somebody coming after you. From the noisome pestilence. Well, that's what's going on now in the land. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. Like giving this picture of, like Jesus said, a mother hen even. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. So God's truth, it brings to mind what Paul said. It's the last piece of the armor that went on, the buckler. It's going to hold me together, but also protects me from the incoming missiles. Thou shalt not be afraid, verse 5, for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, things you can't see, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday, the things you can see. Yikes. You know, do you remember when CNN was not a 24-hour news cycle? You remember that? Do you remember when TV went off? Now, Pastor Sam, I know you don't. There were three channels, and then the UHF. You had a few more of that fuzzy. And then you had your antennas and all of you, you know about that. But CNN, it wasn't 24-hour news. I remember it, and I think Fox only started in, I want to say, 96, maybe. The 24-hour news cycle. So if you don't know there's something bad going on in the world, just turn on your TV, and they will tell you, and they will continue to tell you in so many ways. Well, this verse here says, you know, to be afraid, verse 5, the terror by night, the arrow by day, what you can't see in the dark and what you can see when the sun's out. And there's a lot of stuff. Like I said, the virus is one thing, but it's those who are behind all of this and using these things. This is what Elijah's having to remind himself of. Why is there a famine? Because there is sin in the land. He had to stand up to the king who was putting up idols and groves and worshiping the king of Israel, the God's king, the one that should have been doing right was doing wrong. And Elijah stood up, and now he's also paying a price. Verse 7, 1,000 shall fall at thy side, 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. Now, we talk about this name it and claim it. God allows his children to go through things. We might pray in like fashion as the psalmist did here. We might believe in like fashion as the psalmist did. And we know that God miraculously delivered David from Goliath. He delivered Elijah from Jezebel. He delivered Jonah from the whale. Joseph from the pit. All of these things. But the Lord can deliver us as well. And there are other times where the Lord chooses not to deliver us, to heal us, or to take us out of said problem. But we know that God will move heaven and earth to take care of us as we go through it. That's why you read a psalm like this and it says it won't even touch you. But then you read Psalm 23 and the same guy writes and says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. So here's the one guy saying, I'm not going to be touched by this. You don't have to be afraid by what happens, by what you can't see, what you can see. But I am walking through the valley of the shadow of death. This is hard, but you're with me. So the difference is Elijah had the Lord with him. Ahab had Jezebel. And who wants that trade-off? Not me. I'll take the Lord every time. Number 6, quickly. So God uses dry brooks and dirty ravens to feed his patient servants. And I put that word patient in there because I'm so impatient. We're all so impatient. You know, have you seen the line at? You know, we name it. You know, we went to Walmart the other day and there were only two lines in Middleburg, two lines at the Middleburg Walmart open. And then you had the long lines throughout the self-checkout. Because everybody's just trying. I'm like, oh my goodness, we're impatient. Just not just with lines in our life, but with getting the answer that we desire. But what does Isaiah 40 verse 31 say, number 7 here? Those that wait on the Lord, they'll renew their strength. Mount up with wings as eagle. Run and not be weary. Walk and not faint. All those are action things. Those that wait, which is inaction, result in action. That's really what it is. Elijah obeyed. There was action. And then God put him or hid him somewhere where there was inaction. So we think about this. When we act on God's promises and we wait on him, he takes care of us. It might not be through everything that we want or what the world says we must have, but the Lord takes care of us. Number 8, finally. So what's a good lesson to learn from testing here in Elijah's life? Well, let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 1, and then we'll close with this verse. What's a good lesson to learn from testing? Elijah, in specifics, what do we do when our brook dries up? What do we do? I think Pastor Chris has told me this with Brother Ken, Brother Herring, when he was here. What was it during the 2008? Was it $1,000? The church had, the funds had gotten down to $1,000, and you remember the market crash of 08. I remember how it was in Connecticut, and down here, and the new building, and other things that were going on, and the funds got so low, and a letter was sent out to the church family and just said, listen, this is not good. We're down here. We need to pay our bills. How are we going to do this? Well, the church responded, the church, the body of Christ, at that point. So what do we do when our brook dries up, whether it be financial, physical, relational, emotional, can we say mental, all of the things that we think about, that we react to? What do? We have to understand that God still has a plan. God still has a plan. God wasn't done with Elijah just because the brook dried up. It was a result of the sin in the world. What we're dealing with now is a result of sin. As it was in the days of Noah. Hello, we're there. There is an ark in Kentucky, which is stranger things have truly happened. But as it was in the days of Noah, we are in those days. People don't care about God at all. Someone is going to stand up, rise up, and say, I've got the solution to this, and this is how we solve the problem of whatever. Governments will coalesce, and this guy will stand up and say, here it is, see ya, I'm out of here. Well, ultimately, we're living in those days. Brooks are drying up. People are seeking answers. What are we supposed to do? Well, God has a plan. We can still trust him. And often, throughout our pain, our problems, our testing, he uses us to be a help to others. So we see this in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Look at this verse, if you would. It says this, God, who comforteth us in all our tribulation, let's use the word problems, our testing, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. It's like sharing your quilt with someone who's cold while not losing. It's a big quilt. My grandmother had one of those on her bed, and she used to make those, and those, I could still just even rubbing my hand across just the feeling, the texture of it. But yeah, grandma's quilt was big enough for all the grandkids. And when we are comforted of the Lord, he takes care of us. He uses us then to be a comfort to others. God's blanket is big enough to take care of all of us. So don't cinch up the covers just to yourself. Like, sometimes we do that with how we treat other people. God, don't let your problems cause you to bundle up and isolate yourself. And we're seeing that with COVID. So many people, they're bundling up and they're just, I don't know what to do. It's tough. And I'm not saying this in a mean way, but God is still God. He's still in charge, and we can trust him. And more even than that, God in you, the Lord in us, can use our problems and how we have responded to them to be a blessing to help cover and comfort other people. So let's not be down about our situation, down about what's going on. And we might have felt like my son Joseph this morning. It's going to be a bad day, I can tell it. And maybe we feel like that, but let's go out not on our feelings, but based on our faith and say, God, you're in charge. I trust you. And now use me to help other people. Let's pray.